And it's not senility yet. So it was because I was praying. God bless you. Good morning, everyone. So we have wonderful faces here today. We also have some new people here today, Sylvie and Johnny. Thank you for being here today. And they met some of our people yesterday who were packing groceries at Super C. So this is how the word was spread. This is wonderful. So thank you. As for announcements today, I'd like, where's John? There's John. Okay, John. John will announce.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And thanks for praying. We had a really great time yesterday at the bagging groceries. And so we'd like to do it again. So we'd like to invite you, you know, anybody who wants to come and take part in that. We have nice yellow shirts that the Dennis and their family made. Looks very sharp. And so it was very positive. People enjoyed having their bags, you know, the groceries, you know, packed and things like that. And thank God they gave a lot of money. And because partly it's for Rwanda, right? We would say it's for Rwanda and the people who were poor and things like that. And they really appreciated that. And so they gave $1,000 for it. Mm-hmm. So please consider coming next week. You know, it was, we started about 9, but you could come whatever time you'd like. And it helps a lot, you know, to fill in, to be part of this effort. So also, I wanted to announce a couple things. One is that Barbara is going to be having a remembrance service for Phil. Do you remember Phil? He was a believer that came here sometimes. And so he passed away last year. And we want to remember him on the 4th. So that's, you know, May 4th. That's going to be at what time? 10? 10:30 in the morning on Saturday, the 4th of May. And I think Pastor Fidel is going to do the service, you know, to remember him and celebrate his life. He's a very wonderful man. And he's in heaven. So we got a great, beautiful testimony about Phil. So please consider coming for that. And then also in the evening on the 4th is a concert. So maybe you could consider coming for that. It's a Christian Farmers concert. And we're going to talk about what we did last year and what we're going to hopefully do this year. And, you know, there'll be desserts and music. So I think it'll be a fun time. So please consider coming for that. And we have special treats today. We have cake, because it's Pastor Fidel's birthday. This week, Wednesday or Tuesday? Sometime. Tuesday or Wednesday? The 16th. Oh, I can't count. 16th, right? Yeah, Tuesday. Yeah, got you. So please remember him this week because it's very beautiful. And also, so because of that, we have birthday cake, but also Nicole brought food. So she's made sandwiches and she has pickles and a few things like that. So we're going to put it at the back table and you can have some. Please consider eating. And so there are two things we're planning today. We're going to have one thing, so it's going to be a planning thing for the next events. Like we're going to have hopefully another event for fundraising for Rwanda. So please pray that we can do something good, you know, hopefully some of you would like to stay after church and do some craft work. So some of you could do that. We have different items for Christian Farmers. So we want to take little pieces of tape and snip it off and stick it on to items. So those are little gifts, you know, we'd like to give them away to people. So if you'd like to do a little craft work after church, that'd be great if you could stay. So that's probably going to be in the basement. So please consider that.
And also after church, those who are going to be participating in the missions. If you will still please stay after church, because there's going to be also Pastor Fidel will be doing some planning. Yes, and fun. Yes. That's also, I've asked Don this morning if he would give us a little testimony, and he accepted. So Don, if you will.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I want to thank everybody for their prayers. And also, there were people that brought us food. Well, when I came out of the hospital, I want to thank them too. And I was pretty sick. I was in the hospital for over a month. Had a cardiac arrest, called the ambulance. I died on the way to the hospital, but I'm still here. God. It wasn't my time. And I guess my wife is not feeling very good these days either. So I would like prayer for her and also for me. And I want to thank everybody. Just God bless you all.
Let's just pray for this family. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that whether we are here or there, it's you that matters. Thank you for Don and his faith that shines so beautifully on his face. Thank you that you have recovered and restored him to us. We cherish him, Lord. Thank you. Bless him. Give him health. We pray for his wife, that as a couple they will experience your health. Grant them health. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the church, everyone who has worked and prayed and brought food. We give you all the glory. It's all of you, Lord. Nothing good can come out of foreign humans. Any good we see you. So we bless you. We thank you that he's here. I pray that just continue to hold his hand and his wife and give them and us more days of just praising you together. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'd like to read to you something that's very dear to me and is a staple for us as Christians. And I find it very fitting right now for the time in which we are living here at the Potter's Wheel, the growth that is happening. And so this is the armor of God. As many of you know this prayer, but I found it fitting to read this to you today. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then. With the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. You know, you see the armor as you mentioned this. This is definitely very significant in the spiritual realm. It was in the flesh very, very important because they would put on an armor. And I want you to see this, right? I want you to see this. So try to picture something here, and it has great significance. So you have the truth, which is your balance. It's the waist. It's your truth, and Jesus is the truth. We know that. So Jesus is your balance. And then you have the breastplate, and that protects your heart. And that's the righteousness of God, is to be in right standing with Him. That protects you. Your feet, ready to go to spread the gospel of peace. And then you have you have the shield of faith, without which the arrows, the flaming arrows, will get to you. And then you have, of course, the helmet of salvation, which protects your mind. All of these are for defense. But the only thing that is for offense is the sword of the Spirit, which is double-edged sword. With this, you fight war. So I want you to take up that sword. And that sword will get you through the difficult times. Protect yourself. Have the sword. And in the Roman times, the Romans had the greatest armies on earth because they had this tortoise formation. It was shields on top, shields on the sides, and they walked together. And that's unity of spirit. So in unity of spirit, we walk, walking about with that formation, and we go and we protect ourselves, and we need this to grow as a church and individually. So just remember this. This is one of the most important things to remember as Christians, that we are not fighting this war in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And it is something we need as a body to go forward. Amen. So let's just bow down and pray. Father God, I thank you for your word, Lord God. It is essential for the battle ahead. I pray, Lord God, today, that this congregation, Lord God, that your children here at the Potter's Wheel are focused on the battle ahead, not with fear, but in faith, knowing that their feet are shod firm in truth. And Lord, I pray for the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, to increase in each and every one of us here at the Potter's Wheel. To increase in us, Lord God, so that the power of God and the Holy Spirit may increase in us. So that we may see victory, we may see testimony, we may see, Lord God, growth, and we may see the souls of the unsaved saved in the name of Jesus. I pray your special anointing upon your people here, Lord God, going forward. And I thank you, Lord God, that we are growing in faith and knowledge, in truth, in peace, in joy, and in mercy, oh Lord God, every day. From glory to glory, I pray we grow, Lord God. And I thank you, Lord God, that you take us on the path of righteousness always. I thank you for the message today. I thank you, Lord God, that it is delivered by none other than the Holy Spirit, always, Father God, giving us and telling us all about you. And I thank you for all the people here today. I pray for peace and for understanding in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so I guess we will need two children. I saw Zion. Oh, we did you two though last week, eh? Maybe we switch it up a little bit? We have other, oh no, they're downstairs? Okay. So come. Yes. Done. Okay. So you know what? As the children take up the offering, we'll pray for the offering, and as the children take up the offering, we'll pray for George. All right. Oh, yes. Yeah. All right. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your provision, and I thank you, Father God, that you bless it today. You bless the giver and the gift. And I thank you, Lord, that you have your way here today and that your purpose will be served in Jesus' name. Amen. Father God, we thank you for the needs of the church and for the requests that we bring before you and we lay at the foot of the cross. Lord, we pray for George. We pray, Lord God, that the suffering that he's being faced with right now is not in vain in his life, but that it will turn his face toward you, Lord God, knowing that this battle is greater than what he can face or handle himself. So, Lord, I pray right now, first and foremost, for his eyes to be opened and so that he may see the need to call upon you and be saved. And I pray for his body. I pray that you touch him and that you heal him in the name of Jesus, Lord God, however you wish to do so. And I thank you, Lord, that you bring in his life abundant life and grace in Jesus' name. I also continue to pray for Dawn and Nicole. And I thank you, Lord God, for all the requests of the church today that are spoken and unspoken, and that your healing runs through here in Jesus' name. Amen. I think we should dismiss the children. Okay. All right. So we thank you, Lord, for our children as they are the tomorrow of this church. And we thank you, Lord God, that you grow in them and you grow their spirit and you grow their walk and their boldness and let them be light in these dark days. And thank you, Lord God, that they will spread the good news around them and that you will, through your Holy Spirit, guide them in Jesus' name. And Lord, let it be a good day downstairs today and let them be taught by you and bless the teacher in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Today I'm so happy to share with, I'm so happy to sing with you this song, which says, Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Who is ready to sing with me?
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Our God is good, doesn't change, doesn't change. He's always good to us. He's faithful, he's amazing. Now we're gonna sing this song which says, he's unchanging. Our God is great. Our God doesn't change. He's always the same, yesterday, today, and forever. It doesn't change. Amen. Your faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. You never fail, you never change, oh God. True are your promises, true are your promises. You never fail, you never change. This song is my favorite. As the deer panteth for the water, so my heart. Thank you, Lord. We need you, Lord. One more time, you alone are my heart's desire.
majesty, majesty, your grace has found me. Your grace has found me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hand. Sing it again. Majesty, majesty, forever. Forever I am changed by your love, in the presence of your majesty.
Amen.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Majesty, oh Majesty, your grace has found me just as I am, empty-handed but alive in your hand. You know, it's the last line says, forever I am changed by your love. And today I'm going to look at how God changes us. How does God bring the work of change in a believer? Don't know if my helper is around here. George? I think he's gone. He knows what I'm talking about. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your majesty that you bring to us. And you enable us to fellowship with God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Even now, Lord, come and continue the work of changing us, making us more like Jesus. Hallelujah. The whole work of the Holy Spirit changing us, making us more like Jesus. Thank you. I like Tim Hortons, but this is water. We're going to read from John chapter 20 and verse 19. John 20, verse 19, says, on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and sighed. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Verse 21, again Jesus said, peace. I think we need to hear this. Peace in our souls. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. It's one of the most powerful statements for a believer to grasp. Not any less, not in any way different. As my Father has sent me, I am sending you. Verse 22, and with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. So we're going to look at the work of transformation that the Holy Spirit brings in a believer so that we may be able to do the work of that the Holy Spirit wants to do through the believer. We have to be transformed first, to be people of peace. Some people think that being a soldier for Jesus means to be always angry and upset and almost at war. The way we fight is different. We do not wage the war in the flesh. Our weapon is peace. The peace of God. Even now, may the peace of the Lord come in your heart and be able to give you a sense of stability. As my Father has sent me, I am sending you. Jesus had just been raised from the dead. People, they had hoped that he was going to really be with them and strengthen them and lead them to be to do everything that he had said he was going to do. And then he dies. And some are whispering and there are rumors that he has come from the dead. On this day, he appears in the midst. The doors are locked. You know, it's the same thing going on right now. He is right here. Do you believe it? He is right here. We can sense his presence. And we say, we honor you, Lord Jesus, for your love, your commitment to us. We thank you. And then as he appears, he connects two things, the way he is sent and the Holy Spirit. He says, as my Father has sent me, I am sending you. And then he breathes on them. He says, receive the Holy Spirit. I think there is something he wants us to get there. How did the Father send him? Through, by the Holy Spirit. By the help of the Holy Spirit. The statement is, my Father has sent me, I am sending you, means two things. Those of you who come here, you know, you're getting used to, I like to hear you saying some words by yourself so that you can, you know, sometimes when we say things, they enter. Repeat this with me if you don't mind. The way the Father sent the Son, and the way he's sending me, is in the same manner, no otherwise, and no less. Two things really to remember. It's not a different way and a different strategy, a different way of doing things, and it's not a lesser way. As my Father has sent me, I am sending you. Now you're starting to realize that the Holy Spirit's work, as it was important in Jesus' life, it has to be just as important in our life. This is a continuation of last week. You're starting to put the two together. Last week we spoke about the person of the Holy Spirit. That the Holy Spirit is not a power that I get hold of and use for my own purposes. It's a person who gets hold of me and uses me for his own purposes. He's not some kind of influence I can yield to understand scripture and to be a good person. When you see the Holy Spirit that way, then you're going to want to use him. That is heresy. We do not use God. We yield to God. And he uses us. So the role of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' life is vital for us to get a good picture of what that was. Jesus did all through the Holy Spirit. Everything. Some of it he did it as God using his own spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. For example, when he says, I have the power to forgive sin. That's God talking. No human being has the power to forgive sin. Some of the things he did it as God, but still through his own spirit. And then other things he did as man, as a human being, but again, through the Spirit of God. You will find Jesus praying. You find Jesus saying, my Father. You know, he's wearing a body like us. So whatever Jesus did as a man, he did it through the Spirit of God. Whatever he did as God, he did through his own spirit as God. So whatever theology you have, whether in his humanity or his divinity, you're going to find that is still through the same spirit. As my Father has sent me, I am sending you. In Acts chapter 10, verse 38, we read the narrative is God 38 to 40, but I will read this passage. It says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. So in the book of Acts, they are showing us that God, the Holy Spirit was on Jesus Christ. So let's try to go into details and see the place of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' ministry. Is April here? When we had the meeting on Thursday, it was so interesting. Many of the scriptures I have, April was saying, let's read that. And she was pointing to a lot of these scriptures, which made me realize that the Holy Spirit is saying the same thing to many of us. So we're going to read a few passages, but the Spirit found a home in Jesus first. It's one thing we have to think and grasp. He found a home in him. We see that through the waters of baptism, Luke chapter 3, verse 21, he descended and found a home in him. And then through the wilderness experience, the Spirit took a stand in him. He found a home first and then took a stand in him. And then when he returned to Galilee, chapter 4, verse 14, the Spirit now launched his work through him. Three things. He found a home first in him, and then he took a stand by engaging the devil. And then we read that after that experience, Jesus appeared in Galilee, full of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is now launching the war, a Holy Spirit waging a war against evil spirits. This is the only thing that is going on through us. It's the Holy Spirit against the evil spirits. We just yield and submit. The Holy Spirit has to find a firm footing in your heart. He found a firm footing in Jesus' life. Let's see the first one. The Holy Spirit had found a home in his heart. Luke 3:21, it says, when all the people were being baptized, Luke chapter 3, verse 21, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. You know, the dove seeks a place to rest. And that was the Holy Spirit in a physical form. And the dove also represents peace, gentleness. And the voice came from heaven, you are my son whom I love, with whom I am well pleased. So that on that moment, the Holy Spirit establishes his home in the person of Jesus as a human being. Number two, the Holy Spirit took a stand in his heart. Luke 4:1, we read, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan, was led by the Spirit. Let me read that again. Jesus, full of the Spirit, was led by the Spirit. You see that? Luke 4:1. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. You see, the work belongs to the Spirit of God. He is the one who has filled him, found a home in him, but now he has to go confront the evil spirits. But not in his human abilities, he's led by the Holy Spirit. Some of the things we find there in the wilderness when he's facing the devil are interesting. Like for us, we're going to see that this, we have the flesh, we have the sinful nature. And sin is in us. We do not need to go looking for sin out there. We just have to rise above it and live by the Spirit. Then you do not submit to sin or sinful tendencies. But with Jesus, sin was attacking him from without. If trying to sow seeds, try to make him do things that he would normally not do, and Jesus, led by the Holy Spirit, used his scriptures to counter the devil. As a believer, there are two things you really need to hold tightly onto. One is the Word of God. Another is the Spirit of God. If you are all Word and no Spirit, you dry up. If you are all Spirit and all Word, what happens?
No action.
You are like a balloon that ends up anywhere. I always ask people, how do you know? You're seeking experiences, that's good. But how do you know that the God you're pursuing is the real God? For me, I like to read a lot of books, even from people I don't agree with. I read their books. There's one I was listening to this week, and they're saying, we can't worry about theology, we are seeking the person of God. I thought, wow, that's heresy. Because how do you know this person is real? It's not the counterfeit if you don't have the truth. You know, whatever we get, we need to get the real thing, right? I want the real thing. So I would rather go slowly, but making sure that the Spirit I am seeking is the same one that has inspired scriptures. Because there's so many other spirits out there. And then, so he finds a home in him. He finds a firm footing in him in the wilderness. And then we read in Luke chapter 4, verse 14, Jesus returned from Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit, and our news about him spread throughout the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. So at this stage, it's no longer him as a human being. You start to understand the words of Paul. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but another spirit is at work with me. At this stage, it's not the man, it's the Spirit of God. You know, with Jesus, it's different because it's still his own spirit. When you remember that he's also God, but he, the way he sends us, he gives us an example that we cannot do it on our own, apart from his spirit. The Holy Spirit needs a firm footing in the heart. You cannot still be living in sin and hope to have happiness in your life. Sin brings false happiness. And it's so shallow and it's so temporary. But the Holy Spirit can help.
He's to find a home in our hearts. He's to take a stand against sin in our heart, and he's to launch his work through us. The first act of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' life was to announce his sonship. It was at this point that the Father also pronounces his undying love for him. You know, how does God find a home in me? It's by making me believe that I'm a child of God. Do you believe that you have a Father? You have a Father. The words came from heaven, "This is my Son," with the Holy Spirit. You know, you may have had a bad experience with your Father on earth, but you have a better Father. If we are to allow the Holy Spirit to find a home in us, then first we have to believe that God cares, that God loves us. The Spirit first testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. Through the Holy Spirit, God first announces his love for us by forgiving our sins and giving us hope of eternal life. If you have confessed Jesus as your Savior, then you have hope of eternal life. No matter what happens, we have a living hope, and we are loved of God. So that's number one. He finds a home in us by making us believe that we are children of God and that we have a hope. You see, Jesus out of the water, he had a voice. And that was before he had performed any miracles. That he is loved of God. That he's pleasing to God. As John reminded me on Thursday, you know, he had 30 years of life, so he must have done some good already. But for us, we don't know what he did. A lot, we don't know much apart from the experience in the temple when he was a boy. But my point here is that you have to receive God's love and forgiveness for the Holy Spirit to make a home in you. Secondly, the Holy Spirit must take a stand in the heart, a stand against sin, a stand against the flesh. You are no match for your own sinful nature. You are no match for your own sinful tendencies. I see some people agreeing with me. They tried. If you have tried to stop sin in the past, you know what I'm talking about. You try today, tomorrow, you do it again. It's because you're not meant to do that. It's the Spirit of God that opposes the word says that they are in opposition. Let me read that one for you. Galatians 5, verse 16. Galatians 5, 16. It says, "So I say," this is Paul, having tried it, he said, "This is what I say to you. You better listen. This is my conclusion. If you want to be free of sin, I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit." Maybe some of this language may be new to some of you. What we call the flesh is that desire you have to hate someone. You don't even know why. Jealousy just rises. You're always wanting to do things that later will not be good for you. It's with all of us, especially the young people, you have this sexual urge that can overpower you. You are no match for that. God is able to help you. Please listen to me. Ask the Holy Spirit for help on a daily basis. The victory against sin is daily. We don't have yearly victory while we're still here on earth. We overcome on a day-to-day basis. So, let me continue reading. The Spirit wants what is contrary to the flesh, to that desire. They are in conflict with each other. That's why you do not want do what you want. Romans 7, Romans 8, they go into the depths of this. So as it is, the Holy Spirit finds himself sharing the believer's heart with all the habits. You know, when you have received Jesus, some of the old habits may still be there, old nature. And the Holy Spirit is sharing the home with those habits and old practices. He desires to take full control. As my Father has sent me, there's no other way. The Holy Spirit has to take full control. He desires to take full control. So he points to them, to those things. He keeps pointing to them on a regular basis. So in the times like this, when the Holy Spirit is near us, there is grace for you to rise above it. Will you receive it? You know, we do not preach this so that we just go home with a good message. We preach so we are able to change. Hallelujah. That people are able to leave a lifestyle behind and enter a better lifestyle. And by the way, this is good for you. It's good for your life, good for your mental health. It's good for your finances, you know, it's good for your health. If you learn to listen to the Holy Spirit, he will teach you self-control. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. So that is taking a stand in a believer. He has made the home, yes, you are saved, but he needs to take a stand now against the flesh, against the sinful behavior and tendencies. One day, Jesus went in the temple. Can you put John chapter 2, verse 18 up there for us, please? John 2, verse 18. I'm going to talk about how Jesus helps us by his Spirit to take a stand in the heart. So Jesus then responded to him. Go up at the beginning of the stories, maybe verse 5, 6 is when Jesus cleanses the temple. Verse 13. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Next verse. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, doves, and others sitting at the tables. Before we continue this story, Jesus was so clever. He was so intelligent. So this story, you read it, and you think he's talking about physical temple. But it's at the end, verse 18, when he starts to say to them, destroy this temple, and I will raise it up. So as we go through the story, I want you to keep in mind that he's using an illustration of a physical temple, but he's talking about a different kind of temple, the temple of the Holy Spirit. What is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Us, our bodies. So, go back to that verse, 14, in the temple, in my body, in your body, what does he find there? He found people selling cattle. You know, if you think about your life and you examine yourself, you're going to find that there is a lot of business going on. It's always, what shall I do tomorrow? Transactions. Always in the heart. And Jesus comes and he finds someone is always worrying about tomorrow. that is selling and buying. Someone is always thinking, oh, what about that? Oh, what if we did this? They used to use cattle in those days for big business in the fields. They used to use these to make money for businesses. So he finds that there. Next one was, keep the verse there, sheep and doves and others sitting at the tables exchanging money. So when Jesus comes in our lives and he wants to take a stand in us and he finds there is a business going there, what does he say? Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow has enough worries of its own. But first, seek the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. And Jesus starts to turn things around in your life. He says, how am I going to face this business in this man or woman's life? You know, can we go to work yet not worry? Can we still have business in this life yet not worry? That's the work of the Holy Spirit. So, next verse. So he made the whip. He does that in our lives. Do you remember the whipping of the Lord? Yeah. I do. If you haven't met Jesus' whips, they are real. Mm-hmm. They are real. He will make sure he allows circumstances of life. He allows sickness. You know, there are things that God can just take away, but he allows us to go through them. There are trials and difficulties. He can just protect us. But he says, how am I going to let this person stop buying and selling in the temple? He made a whip of cords and droves, and he drove all the temple, all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle, and scattered the coins of the money changers. You know, Jesus comes, if you put money as a god in your life, he will scatter all that. You know, he will be first, and he's not going to have your heart and share it with another idol. You know, at the end, he's going to say, I'm talking about my body, the temple of the Holy Spirit. So we are right interpreting this as this applies to the temple of God now, of the Holy Spirit that we are. So right now, I want you to take a second and think about your life. Are you buying and selling? Is there money changing all the time? Are you in business always? And Jesus will say, next verse, those who sold doves, he said, get this out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a bucket. The temple of the Holy Spirit. He says, this house shall be a house of prayer. That's your body. It should be a house of prayer. Always meditating on God. Always having psalms, always having songs. I am yours, Lord. Help me. That's the verse that is always in my heart. I am yours, Lord. Cleanse me. I am yours, Lord. Purify me. Next one. His disciples remembered that it is written, zeal for your house will consume me. Next verse. The Jews then responded to him, what sign can you show us to prove your authority? Next one. Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days. So he's talking about the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit today, you know, Paul teaches us that, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? So we are to really think about how we worry about this life and allow God to take the worries away. Yes, we wake up and go to work, but as you're going, be praying at Maxi. Be saying, Lord, cover my heart. Don't let me worry. Have a song going in your spirit. As you are at school, ask yourself, Holy Spirit, do you have a stand in me right now? With sin start to rise up, let the Holy Spirit tune you so you can hear. Because he speaks against sin. So Jesus saw his body as a temple. We have to do the same. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19, it says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. He is to take a stand in you against sin, against temptation, against habits. Anything that you yourself think about and you feel, I should not be doing this. He wants to take a stand against that and push it to the side. And I'm saying this with so much testimony behind, that this is a possibility. And he keeps doing it all over and over and over. And the things he used to do yesterday, now he points to them again. And he doesn't judge you, but he shows you that, yeah, you can do better. I can help you. It is your body, a temple. Or shall I ask this way? Is your body a temple or a marketplace? All right, I'm going to get towards the last point. If you can remember my sermon today, the Holy Spirit is to take a home, to find a home. He is to find, to take a stand and then launch us. Many of us want to go and serve and do things, yet we don't know whether the Holy Spirit has taken stand against sin in our lives. The Holy Spirit must launch his work against sin through us, and through us, launch the work in the world. Let's read John 20:23, where we were earlier. John 20 and verse 23. If you forgive anyone's sin, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. So there's truth here. He's to launch us in the work against sin in the world. The church, we are here so that we can do the work of the Holy Spirit. And his work, the same with through Jesus, is to eradicate sin. First through us and then in the world. The kingdom of God is at hand. It's a holy kingdom. You know, in these days, you go to many churches, you don't hear this word sin being spoken. We don't hear it a lot. But I don't think we are loving our people. That's not love. Because if I see a sickness or a problem in you, or if you see it in me, and you say, oh, I don't want to talk about it, so that I'm loving, that's not love. Sin is bad. It causes harm. It causes issues, breaks families. So if there is anything that the church should be talking about, is how the Spirit of God provides for people to rise against sin. So yeah, it says, I will launch you in the work through you. We got to know here that there will be less sin. His plan is to work in us in such a way that in some measure we think and feel as Christ feels concerning sin. Shall I repeat that? The work of the Holy Spirit is to work in us so that in some measure we think and feel the same way that Jesus feels and thinks about sin. So we don't have a different standard that Jesus has. As my Father has sent me, I am sending you. He produces a beautiful harmony between his witness in us and his witness through us. These things have to go together. The work he does in me and the work he does through me, there has to remain a balance, a harmony. Otherwise, we become hypocritical. We fake it. We don't have to. What he's doing through me, it's only a matter of time. He's going to bless others around me. So there is a beautiful harmony between the witness of the Spirit in a believer and the witness of the Spirit through a believer to the world. Sometimes we fall into these two errors. We either condemn what we are doing ourselves. You say, oh, that's not right. You should not be doing that. But yet you are living the same life. Or we become indifferent. We just don't want to offend anyone. You just keep quiet. The Holy Spirit wants me. Maybe I should say me, so that you don't think I'm talking. The church. He's here to remove the plaque out of our eyes so we can see clearly. It doesn't say, oh, don't look at the plaque in someone's eyes. Just look the other way. No, it says first remove what is wrong in your life. Then you will be able to have the power to help others. So do not condemn and judge what you are doing yourself, but also do not become indifferent. And there's another one. You secretly think, I am better than that person. I'm holier than thou. That's not the Holy Spirit. That's not the conviction of the Spirit. If you see something wrong, my prayer is that we have the same attitude towards sin as Jesus has. What is it? How does Jesus in his ministry, when he was on earth, how did he see this issue of sin? Number one, you have to see the Father's love. Number two, you have to see the bondage of sin. Number three, you have to see the possibility of deliverance. The Father's love, or the Father's honor, the Father's majesty, remember we were singing? Majesty. If a believer sees the majesty of God, then you want to uphold his holiness. When we approach sin and we encounter it, whether in us or in others, the honor of God should rise in us and think, oh, that is defaming the holiness of God. That is wrong. God is holy and pure and majestic. So a believer needs to have a revelation of the majesty of the Father. We sing, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You know what that means? Yeah. But it means let the whole world maintain your holiness. Let every creature be aware of the holiness of the Father. So when there's a sin in our lives, the first thing that should come is, oh, this is an offense to the holiness of God. Before you even start to think about how he's hurting and how he's going to be punishing anything, just have a revelation of the Father's beauty. And just hold on to that for a while. And in your life, you're going to feel like you don't want to sin anymore. That will equip you. It will empower you. The God we serve is altogether pure. And the next thing you need to see is the bondage that it brings to people who sin. The bondage that sin brings in our lives. We need to be able to love the sinner but hate the sin. See its evil. See how much peace it takes from people. See how much it destroys communities and families and nations. Today, see what's going on in the Middle East, in Europe, my own continent of Africa.
In America right now, so I'm falling.
Everywhere, bondage of sin is destroying lives. So not only we see the holiness of the Father, but we see the evilness or the ugliness of sin. Separate the two. Separate me and love me from my sin and hate that. And that's why sometimes legalism kicks in. Oh, I can't talk to that person, he's a sinner. The Father loves that person but hates the sin. So see the holiness of God, see the bondage of sin, but also see the cross. Let the cross intervene in this scenario. The possibility of deliverance is there. If we don't see the possibility of deliverance, then what are we doing? There has to be faith. There is a reason Jesus went to the cross, so that sin may be done away with. So as we approach sin and we know the Holy Spirit has taken residence in us and he has dealt with our own sin and he's in the process, then we need to be launched in our ministry, in our service. You know, wherever you go to work, you are a servant of God. You can go serving Jesus in any way as you can. But remember, the possibility of deliverance has been paid for. There's no sin that is more powerful than the cross. There is no bondage that is more powerful than the cross. I want to pray right now. I rebuke any kind of bondage in this place. Any sinful tendencies, you shall leave the people of God. Jesus Christ paid it all. And all to him we owe. So I receive deliverance for us through the power of Jesus. So carry these things as you go through your day. The majesty of the Son of God and the Father, the triune God, holy. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Spirit. And then remember that sin is evil. It's going to bring pain. It's bondage. So we need to have the love for the sinners. And then remember that the cross has provided for it. So as we conclude, the leading of the Holy Spirit, you know, in charismatic movements, we talk about being led by the Holy Spirit as if it's all on his side. It's like a coin of two sides. The leading of the Holy Spirit is one side. My submission, submitting to the Holy Spirit, is another side to it. We have to submit to the Holy Spirit. Surrender. Your greatest enemy, which is your flesh. Surrender it on a daily basis. Aim at nothing less than the glory of the Son. As you go through your day, aim at nothing else. Only the glory of Jesus. Think about it this way. Say, today, I want to maintain your glory, whatever I am. The willingness to die like your Savior on a daily basis, dying to sin, let it be there. The one reason the Holy Spirit was sent into the earth was that sin might be conquered. And he has been doing it throughout the centuries. Sin has been conquered through people. And I'm saying good news today. If you remain with the Holy Spirit, you're going to conquer sin. And 5 years from now, you're going to be praising God. It is possible. It is such a joy. The reason a believer should seek the fullness of the experience of the Holy Spirit is so that he can conquer in you. Will you be a vessel fully surrendered for him to wage a war against sin in and through you? I'm finishing. I'm done, actually. Let us stand. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to pay to receive the Holy Spirit. Peter was talking to the thousands on the day of Pentecost. He said, the Holy Spirit is a gift, and it is for you and your children and all those the Lord our God will call. That includes all of us. So don't fight your flesh with the flesh. The flesh cannot fight itself. Let the Holy Spirit help you to wage the war. So let us pray together. Repeat after me. Help me, Lord. Help me today. Just for today. Help me to overcome. Give me a different sight. Give me a new eyesight to see the glory of the Father. Give me love to love the sinner, even in my own family, even my own friends. But see the bondage in sin, even in my own sin. But Lord, help me today to see the cross and see the possibility of deliverance from sin. In the mighty name of Jesus, I receive and I thank you daily, daily, that I will live in victory. Jesus Christ, by His Spirit, will find a home in me, will find a firm footing in me, will take a stand in me, and He will launch me in the work of the kingdom. In the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. If you like prayer, there are people who are going to be here at the front, the elders. We spoke about it. I'm going to go at the back and shake your hand. Have a wonderful week.